Hello students, myself Suresh V.S. Welcome back to my channel. Today we are going to learn a poem from your textbook First Flight. The title of the poem is The Ball Poem, written by John Berryman. Yes, the poet's name is John Berryman. He was an American poet and a scholar. He was a well-known poet of America. Okay? So this poem has been taken from his collection of poems known as Dream Songs, which contains 385 poems written in a sequence. And for that, he got Pulitzer Prize, one of the renowned prize for literature. Okay? See, after seeing the title, I know very well that you would have thought what a silly title it is. Ball poem. What a silly title it is. But dear students, this poem is really interesting as well as meaningful. It is really meaningful in our life. It's talking about loss. The loss that can happen at any time in our life. We have to face the harsh realities, hardships and miseries in life, but we have to stand up against it and move forward. So I'm going to explain line by line with the poetic device. So let us go through the poem. What is the boy now who has lost his ball? See, the poem starts with the boy and the loss of ball. A boy lost his ball. See, a boy was playing with his ball in a harbor. Immediately what happened? The ball fell down from his hand and went into a water body. See, the poet was standing there or sitting there and he was watching it. So he is asking to the readers, or he might be asking himself, what is the boy now who has lost his ball? What happened to the boy who had lost his ball? He is very much eager to know about the boy. What would have been his reaction after losing his ball? So he is asking, what happened to the boy who had lost his ball? What is he to do? What is he going to do now? He wants to know that. What is he going to do now? I saw it go. I here stands for the poet. It stands for the ball. He says that he has seen the ball going down. He saw the ball fell down from the hands of the boy and going down into the water body. So he witnessed it, merrily bouncing down the street, and then merrily over there it is in the water. How did the ball go? The movement of the ball is told such a way, merrily. Merrily means cheerfully. Cheerfully bouncing, that means jumping up and down. Cheerfully bouncing or jumping up and down the street. First of all, it went into the street. From there, where did it go? From there, it went into the water body. It can be the river. So it went into the river. See, the ball bouncing happily, cheerfully. So here, you see that feeling. Actually, the ball will not have such feelings like happiness and all. So the poet has used an important device, poetic device here, that is personification. And you see that in these four lines, in the beginning, what these two lines, in the consecutive lines, what the word has been repeated. So the poetic device used here is anaphora. And again here merrily, then next line also merrily. So anaphora has been used again. Then merrily bouncing down, an image has been created in the mind of the reader. So the poetic device, that is imagery. See, in the first line, you can see that vowel sound O in B, O, Y, N, O, O, N, O, W. And again, W, O, the O sound that has been vowel sound that has been used here. So, the poetic device used here, that is assonance. Okay? So, these are the important poetic devices used in these four lines. Okay? So, what did the poet see? He saw the ball going from the hands of the boy, and the poet was really helpless. The boy was also helpless. Okay. So, once the boy lost the ball, what did he do? Yes. Noah used to say, oh, these are other balls. So, the poet says that the boy was really unhappy. He was really sad. An ultimate shaking grief fixes the boy. Once the boy lost the ball, you see that an ultimate, it's complete, and complete shaking grief. Okay, that means he was completely affected with the pain and sadness. He was really sad. He became sad. He was surrounded with sorrow. So to that boy, he says that there was no use of telling there are other balls. Why? So he might have got many other balls, or the poet himself can purchase and give one ball to him. He can get other ball, telling that you can get other balls. He can console him. But the poet says that there is no use to tell that, oh, there are other balls. That means he does not want to console him, telling that there are other balls, because he does not give importance to other balls. He is too much attached to the ball which one he has lost. See, in our life we have many objects which are very dear to us. When we lose it, you see that how much pain it caused for us. See, that can be the objects, that can be some beloved ones, very dear to us. The loss of such people, the loss of such objects cause great pain to us. So suppose I have been gifted a pen by my friend on my birthday, and if I lose it, even though it was not so costly, but I have added certain values to that. So I consider that pen gifted my friend or my parents as very precious. If it is lost, really, I couldn't bear it. So we can get so many pens, but I give more importance to the pen that was given to me by my friend or my parents. Same like you see that this ball, he has played with it for a long time. So he has been so much attached to it. So all his childhood memories are connected to it. So if you give other balls, that balls cannot replace that memories which he had with that ball. It is not only a playing object for him. It is something else. It is more than that. Okay, so just telling that there are other balls, it won't make the boy happy or remove his sorrow. So he says that there is no use to say, oh, there are other balls. As he stands rigid, trembling, staring down, what does he do? He stands there. He stands in one place, rigid. Rigid means without any movement. Stiff. You see that when sometimes you see that after seeing some horrible sights or some matters that affect us too much, we could not bear it. So that time we stand like a statue, erect, without any motion, without any movement. Here the boy, you see that he is shocked, really shocked. He can't bear it. So he stands there, erect or straight, rigid. And he is trembling with fear and staring down. What is he doing? He is staring down. He is looking down. Where is he looking down? The ball that has been gone to the water, and it remains still there. He can see the ball, but he could not get it back. He can't get it back. He is helpless. Okay, so he is staring, yes, at his ball, which has been in the the water body. All his young days into the harbor. You see that the ball has been, as I told you, so the ball is very precious for him because all his childhood memories, yes, sweet memories are connected to it, are linked to it. Okay, and he used to come to the harbor and play there for a long time. He has played in that harbor for a long time. He has spent his childhood there. So now he feels that his childhood has gone. Here ball signifies his lost childhood. Okay. And you see the harbor, that is the vast world, vast life. And here his ball went world into it. All his young days into the harbor where his ball went. And you see that he is looking to the place where his ball has gone, and the ball is very much dear to him. He can't forget it. I would not intrude on him. The poet says that I could not intrude, very important. I could not interfere with him. If he wants, he can go and just console him, as well as he can interfere, or he can disturb him. But the poet does not want to disturb him or intrude him, intervene him or meddle with his affair. Why? I would not intrude on him. A dime, another ball is worthless. He says that a dime that is equal to 10 cent US money. So that means the ball is not a costly one. It's a very cheap one. With some money he could purchase a ball and give to the boy. Okay, he could interfere. He could go and tell the boy that no need to be so much worried about it. I can purchase and give one ball to you. But he does not want to do that. So he says that he would not intrude on him. A dime, another ball is worthless. Worthless means meaningless. He says that purchasing or buying another ball and giving to him, okay, that is not at all meaningful. There is no meaning for that. Why? Because the poet thinks that he has to learn very important lesson in his life. He is learning now. He is under learning process. So he must understand the value of the things. We also has got so many things given by our parents or somebody else. Okay, so we have to take care of these things. So now he senses first responsibility in a world of possessions. See, this world is a world of possessions. This is a world of material objects. So many things are there. There we try to find out. So many objects are there. There we try to find out happiness and luxury. And in this world of possessions, it is his duty to take care of his things. He is learning his first lesson of responsibility. That means, before he did not lose a ball in his life. He has not lost a ball in his life. It's first time he loses a ball. So something he lost now. So now he is learning. A person must be responsible about his, okay, or about something. How to deal with the things. Okay, it is the duty of each one of us to deal with the things which are ours. So here the boy learns that first lesson of responsibility. It was his duty to take care of that ball. In that case, it would not have gone down into the water. So next time he would not repeat it. Okay, so he is learning the first lesson of responsibility in a world of possessions. People will take balls, balls will be lost always, little boy. See, people will take balls. So people will take important things, precious things from us, our valuable things that can be taken away, snatched away by people. We have to face it. We have to bear it. And you see that more often we may lose many important things, many of our worldly important things from us, but we have to, yes, face it with courage. Okay, so balls that can be lost always, so that can be in the form of, yes, material things, or that can be in the form of some beloved things, our dearest ones, that can be our friends or our relatives. So loss that is inevitable, we cannot, yes, prevent it. Our life is filled with the, yes, sorrows as well as happiness. There is always up and downs. It doesn't mean that always we go through, yes, happiness only in our life. Okay, we have to face or taste bitter experience too in our life. So there can be always balls will be lost always. There is a possibility for loss in our life. Many things can be lost. Okay, so and no one buys a ball back. So if it is lost, you see that it is very difficult to get it back. Once lost, that is very difficult to get it back. Suppose the loss of our beloved person or a beloved friend, we cannot get it back. So a beloved or a precious things which are very much attached to us can be lost at any time, but it is, we cannot expect them getting back again. Money is external. With money we cannot purchase everything. Money is external. You see that the grief, feelings, belongingness, love, all these things are internal. We cannot purchase with all these things with yes, money. Money is really external. Okay, so money is not everything. Money should not conquer us. Money should not rule us. We should not be ruled by money. Okay, so here you can see that the poetic device used here, a dime, another ball, is worthless. The poetic device used here is accidental. Why accidental? Because no conjunctions are used here. So again you see that balls here, the words are repeated. So the poetic device used here is a repetition. Then again another poetic device is used here, assonance. You see that the vowel sound he has been repeated in all these words. So the poetic device used here is assonance. He is learning, and the money is external. He is learning. So the poet says that the boy is learning now. He is learning a very important lesson in his life. He is going through a process of transformation, a realization, how to face the truth, how to face the reality. It's the truth that the loss that can come at any time in our life, but what do we have to do? Yes, learning well behind his desperate eyes. Desperate means hopeless. He is hopeless now because he lost his ball now. He knows very well that he could not get it back. So behind his hopeless eyes, an important lesson that he is learning in his life, first time in his life, what is that? The epistemology of loss. The epistemology means the knowledge of loss, the lesson of loss that he is learning now, how to stand up. That means how to gather strength and how to strengthen himself. That means when the loss comes in our life, we have to strengthen ourselves. We have to face it. We should not run away from it, the reality. So it has to come once. Everyone's life, you see that we have to face loss. Okay, don't think that all things are always will be along with us. One day the things will lose. That can be the material things or the material objects or even the persons. Okay, so we have to face this loss one day. So what do we have to do? We have to stand up. We have to face it as well as move forward. Gather, yes, our courage, bravery. We must be brave enough to face it and move forward. We have to stand up against this adversity in life, miseries in life. knowing what every man must one day know. So every man, as I told you, must face such a situation. So we could not prevent it. We could not escape from this. It's a harsh reality of life. Loss that can come in our life at any time. Okay? So, and most know many days how to stand up. And most of the people learn it very late in life. But only one thing is that some learn very fast about it. But some people, they learn very late in life. But we have to face this reality. And the real, in our real life, we have to face these miseries, troubles, hardships, great loss. Okay. But we have to stand up against it and move forward or go on. Dear students, I hope all of you understood this poem very well. So please like and subscribe my channel. Thank you for watching it. Thank you. Thank you very much.